Hi, thanks for tuning in. Today's video series is on COPD. My name is Brian Bezik, and I'm a PA. I practice in pulmonary medicine outside of Boise, Idaho, for the Terry Riley Health Centers. These videos are going to focus on patient communication and how we can recognize and advance therapy for COPD. When a patient presents with cough, increased sputum production, maybe shortness of breath, we start to think about the possibility of a COPD diagnosis. This is especially important for primary care. You're going to see these patients long before they make it to a pulmonary specialist. Think about the symptoms they're presenting with and their history. Does it make sense that this patient could be struggling with some kind of chronic pulmonary issue that needs to be evaluated? If so, consider the diagnosis of COPD. When we think about the causes of COPD, we often think about tobacco smoke, and direct exposure to tobacco smoke is the leading cause of COPD in the United States. In fact, 70% of patients will have that direct exposure. 30% won't, however. For 30%, it may be indirect exposure, maybe the secondhand smoke that they got exposed to, maybe occupational exposure, maybe there was a chemical exposure. There's even genetic COPD called alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. So for about 3 out of 10, it's not direct tobacco smoke, so we need to be keeping that in mind if you're considering the diagnosis of COPD. In order to diagnose COPD, we do need spirometry or pulmonary function tests. It's not the end of the diagnosis, but it is a critical part. Gold guidelines give us direction on how to do that. If you get spirometry or PFTs on a patient, you'll get their FEV1 over FVC ratio. This is the ratio of how much air they have versus how much they can get out in 1 second. If the patient has 4 liters of air and they can get out 2 in 1 second, then that 2 liters would indicate 50% of their air came out in that first second, far below the diagnosis needed for the diagnosis of COPD. Once you have the confirmed diagnosis of COPD, there are 5 fundamental aspects that you need to consider when starting therapy and advancing therapy. The first one is the extent of airway obstruction. Just how severe is the obstruction present? That's that ratio we talked about. When it's significantly below 0.7, they struggle to get air out, and that needs to be taken into account. The next point is just how well they're doing at that time. You want to know how they are doing right now, how the things that they can do in their daily life. Are they able to go shopping? Are they able to do laundry? Get an idea of their current level of dyspnea. The easiest way to do that is with the MMRC. This is a 1-question dyspnea scale that is available in the COPD guidelines from Gold, and it gives the patient a number between 0 and 4. The higher numbers, 3 and 4, indicate more shortness of breath and restriction. Lower numbers are less so. It can help you judge just how they're doing today. Which leads to the next question is, how are they doing in the last year? Have they been sick? How many exacerbations have they had, and have any of those been severe? Using that information, you can guide therapy when it comes to assessing where to start, what inhalers to start with, and how to advance therapy. All of that is outlined in the Gold guidelines. The fourth aspect for COPD is the eosinophil count. This is the phenotype. Don't worry, eosinophil counts are already in your chart. There's nothing you have to order. Just look back at their CBCs. See what their eosinophil count was. If it's over 300, that means type 2 inflammation may be playing a role. Be sure to check back over a couple of CBCs, because if the patient had been on oral steroids, that eosinophil level might be low. So check back and find out if type 2 inflammation is a part of this patient's COPD presentation. The fifth one that we want to consider is comorbid conditions. We know COPD is a lung condition, but it affects the entire body, especially the cardiovascular system. So taking that into account can help you decide when to advance therapy and when to seek specialist care. In addition to the 5 points, there's a couple of things I'd like you to consider. First one is healthy lifestyles. Helping the patient eat better, exercise, walk when they can, all of these impact their COPD. And the last thing is the mental health of the patient. COPD is difficult. There's a lot of stress, anxiety, and maybe even depression that goes along with it. Talk with the patient about how they're doing. If needed, connect them with resources to get help. These things impact how they respond to therapy, their exacerbations, and their overall outlook. The next video, we'll delve into a little bit more about how exacerbations affect COPD patients.